An alarm urgently beeps. Code blue. We drop what we're doing and rush down the hall to the patient's room. We gown up, gloves, goggles, face shields, and rush into the room. Our patient, a 50-year-old male, is unresponsive and pulseless. Asystole. We begin ACLS, advanced cardiac life support. We're gonna try any and everything to restart his heart. I am a PGY3 MD, working in the ER of a hospital in a mid-sized city. Just about 2 weeks ago, we mobilized for the coming surge. All non-urgent activity, outpatient, and elective surgeries were canceled. Clinic was converted to telemedicine or rerouted to our sister hospital. The hospital set up large tents in the parking lot as triage for testing. No need to step into the hospital and potentially get infected if you don't test positive. We also set up negative pressure rooms, moved equipment around to try to create the best configuration to minimize cross-contamination. Medical staff underwent a refresher of how to put on and take off PPE, that's personal protective equipment, and we created a buddy system. So before entering a patient's room, we visually check each other to make sure gear was correctly put on. We knew it was going to be hectic, but we deal with some intense situations in the ER on a daily basis. And I thought we were prepared, but we weren't. We began testing as soon as possible. It takes a few days to get the results, so if triage suspects a patient is PUI, that's a person under investigation for COVID-19, it can go one of two ways. If the patient's symptoms are deemed non-urgent, they get sent home to self-quarantine with instructions to come back if they have shortness of breath. The sicker ones come inside to the ER. On the first day, five PUI patients were admitted to the ER during my shift. Another four COVID-positive patients were transferred in from another medical center that was overwhelmed. On my next shift, we admitted 17 COVID patients. In less than a week, the ICU and ER pretty much took over the entire hospital. Now, nearly 90% of our patients are COVID-positive. Usually, there are people streaming in and out of the hospital 24 hours a day. Now, the main lobby is empty, the gift shop is closed, the coffee cart wheeled away. No visitors allowed. It's creepy. Silent like a tomb. The ICU is full of sedated patients hooked up to ventilators. We have 33 patients on vent right now. The ER waiting room is packed and more have spilled out into the hallway. Rasping coughs and gasping dominate the space, punctuated by the beeping of machines and code calls. Anxiety hangs heavy in the air as people wait to be seen, wait for a bed to open up, and in some cases wait to die. Just 3 days ago, the 50-year-old male showed up to be tested. He had a sore throat and was a little short of breath. He was annoyed that triage sent him inside. He hadn't wanted to be tested in the first place. It was no worse than a cold. He wouldn't have come at all except his wife made him. I suggested he stay in the hospital. His sats were in the 80s. Depending on age, a healthy person's oxygen saturation is between 95 and 100. We put him on a high-flow nasal cannula to take some strain off of his lungs. For the first time, he looked worried. He wanted to call his wife. I agreed. Before I stepped away, I remarked on his Packers jersey. I've been trying to show that there is a human behind all the layers of PPE. He told me that he had grown up in Wisconsin. He was a Green Bay fan for life. He smiled. I'm sweating. My goggles are fogging up, but I'm in the middle of chest compressions. I feel a rib pop under my pressing hands. Somewhere inside, I flinch. My visceral reaction to breaking bones never went away. We intubate and bag ventilate. We push epi. Patient has continued asystole. We proceed with ACLS. More epi. We labor a bit more. And then the attending calls it. We can't get him back. It falls on me to call and inform his family. His wife is dazed. She can't believe it. It's never easy. But it's worse not doing it in person. You can't look into their eyes or squeeze their hand. It's hard to know when to be silent or to let them process or keep talking. How much compassion can I show on a phone call? Then I call the operator. We need to get the body moved ASAP and the room cleaned. There are many people waiting on beds. The operator tells me that the transport staff is very busy right now. Other departments are requesting removals too. It's going to be a while. It's only the second hour of my shift. We've learned a lot since our first positive patient. The virus's symptoms vary, everything from headache and muscle aches, bad dry coughs, shortness of breath, even severe diarrhea with dehydration. We adapt and learn as we proceed. Most of our treatment revolves around supporting the body with antibiotics and other medicines, fluids for hydration. As needed, we intubate and put patients on ventilators to keep breathing. In simple terms, I'm trying to assist your body. Give it the time it needs and limit strain so hopefully your immune system can focus and fight off the virus. 29 female. She has on a winter coat and a blanket wrapped around herself to try and stop the chills. In between coughs and chattering teeth, she confesses to me that she vapes. It's like she wants me to scold her and offer some reassurance that her habit hasn't made things worse for her lungs. But I don't know if that's true. I suggest that she call her family. She should designate someone to be in charge of choices for her, in case her condition worsens and renders her unable to make decisions for herself. I FaceTime a husband to update him on his wife of many years. 62 female is the same, on vent, hooked up to an IV drip, receiving a continuous infusion of pain and sedation drugs. She's not getting worse, but her condition isn't improving either. Her husband asks if I can put her on that miracle drug he's heard about. I explain that I can't. The medication is contraindicated because of another she takes for a chronic condition. He screams profanities at me before hanging up. I didn't get a chance to talk to him about a do not resuscitate order or palliative care. Make a note to let him cool off and call him later. Sometimes people think we can fix patients like a mechanic fixes a car, but it doesn't work that way. Human bodies don't work that way, and these days, I often feel helpless. It's late afternoon. I can't ignore the rumbling in my stomach any longer. I carefully take off my N95 mask, putting it into a plastic baggie. We're lacking in PPE, so we're reusing the same mask the entire shift. I wash my hands twice before heading to the cafeteria. A local restaurant has donated a meal. Tacos with all the fixings, brownies for dessert. I snag two. The restaurant has included a card thanking doctors for being heroes, but this is so much bigger than me and my colleagues. Everyone, from the nurses to the respiratory techs to the cleaning staff to security guards directing people in the parking lot to the triage tents to the administration staff, everyone has stepped it up. The cafeteria is quiet. Everyone's exhausted, lost in their own thoughts. No one sits across from each other. Everyone is at least 6 feet apart. People eat quickly so they can get back to work. I make my rounds. 66 male and a 47 female are intubated, on vent, but each rapidly deteriorating in a different way. I doubt either of them will last through the night. We've gotten 4 ventilators from somewhere. I think the government. Housekeeping has cleaned them and brought them up to the ER. An exhausted veteran doctor remarks that he hasn't seen that model since the early 90s. My shift was over 80 minutes ago, but I'm just finally leaving. There's so much to do. I carefully take my mask off. The deep red marks will remain for some time. I sign out. Stepping out of the hospital, I breathe deeply. Fresh air. The first time in nearly 12 hours, I'm outside. At my car, I open my trunk first, slip on a pair of latex gloves. I tow off my shoes and spray them with disinfectant before putting them in a shoebox in the trunk. I put on a pair of flip-flops to drive. At home, parked in my driveway, I wipe down my keys, badge, wallet, phone, and travel mug with sanitizing wipes before I exit my car. On my front steps, I strip. It's awkward trying to take scrubs off without touching the outside. I stuff my scrubs into a trash bag. I stand, shivering in my underwear, while I fumble with my keys to open the door. The house is dark and cold, lonely. My wife went to stay with her parents and took our dog along, safer that way. I deposit the trash bag of clothes into a designated hamper by the washing machine. I catch sight of my face in the bathroom mirror while I wait for my shower to heat up. Lines from my mask are still etched into my skin. In the shower, I use a lot of soap and scrub hard until my skin tingles. I imagine that I'm getting every single virion off me. I warm some leftovers and turn on the TV, more for company than anything else. I flip through a few channels of talking heads while I skim social media on my phone. I quickly give up on both. Everyone has big opinions on what's happening. I just want people to shelter in place, social distance, and flatten the curve. I fall asleep watching a movie I've seen many times before. I brew coffee, filling my large mug. Not as good as my favorite coffee shop, which is now closed due to shelter-in-place orders, but it'll have to do. At the hospital, my temperature's checked. Still normal. I pick up my daily N95 mask. Due to the shortage, the N95 masks are now carefully counted and kept locked up, like narcotics. Putting on PPE feels ritualistic, like I'm suiting up for battle. I take sign out from the previous team. Nearly every patient is the same no matter the age. Cough, shortness of breath, fever, low sats, positive for COVID. Codes are called over and over through my entire shift. We line the hallway, cheering and clapping. She preens, pats her gray hair, and waves like she's in a beauty pageant. The skin around her eyes crinkles, showing that she's grinning under her mask. 77-year-old female. One tough cookie. Surprisingly, she came off the vent, was moved out of the ICU, rehabbed, and now she's being discharged after 26 days in the hospital. It doesn't make sense. She has diabetes. The odds were against her. The sliding doors open, and the attendant pushes her wheelchair out into the sunshine. She has a long road to full recovery, but her prognosis is looking good. Her grand exit is the nicest part of a long, exhausting day. We lose 9 more, and we haven't even peaked yet. Administration thinks the peak is coming next week. They've ordered a second refrigeration truck. While finishing my paperwork for the day, I'm reminded that I'm off tomorrow. 6 days on, 1 day off. I take my mask off, sign out. In my car, I change and disinfect my shoes. I worry that no matter how careful I am, it's inevitable that I'll catch it, but there's no sense in worrying about it. We don't have a choice. We all have to keep pressing on.